One thing that you've seen more and more of in the past few years on my channel is time lapses. We've shown you time lapses of setting up, shooting, tearing down, landscapes, astrophotography, and really anything that happens slowly but looks good when watched quickly. A few things I like about time lapses. One, there are no rules. If you want to do a time lapse a certain way, then that is the right way. Two, they're fun and different. For me, they make me think about a single photo and then how that photo might change over time. You're thinking ahead. It's an added challenge and it keeps my artist brain in top gear. And three, it's mindful. We've done time lapses 8 hours long and even longer. And that gives you 8 hours where you're doing photography, but you'd best not touch the camera. That gives me some time with my lesser used cameras and activities and hobbies outside of photography, all with my camera nearby, clicking away.
Hey everybody, Raymond here, back from hiatus, interrupting Leigh's video to talk about Leigh's other video today. Her current class for members is about classic portrait photography. Just like with time lapses, there's a lot to consider when setting your camera for portraits. I was there while Leigh was filming the current module, and there's an exercise. She's going to set her camera in a portrait situation, and then you can consider the settings that you would use in that situation or your own portrait setting that you might find yourself in as well. If you are a member of the channel, look for the link down in the description of this video below. If you're not a member of the channel, but you're interested in that training class and the others that she's published, check out a link in the description for more information on joining the channel.
Today, I want to talk about some tips for setting up time lapses on a few different Nikon cameras, the Z6, Z7, Z50, D810, and D780. And if you have a D500 or D850 or other Nikon DSLR, your interval timer options will look very similar to one or more of the cameras that I show off in this video. In fact, after I show you the first one, the others that I show you will work much the same. Basically, if you have any Nikon camera that has an interval timer, you have settings similar to or identical to the ones that you'll see in this video. If you have Sony, Fuji, or Leica, I've got videos either out or coming soon for your brand. Check the description of this video for links to those others. Before we review the settings, I do want to say again, there are no rules. If you want to do a time lapse of a plant growing, get ready for short exposures infrequently over a long period of time. If you're doing astrophotography, you're talking fairly long exposures frequently over the course of the night. If you're somewhere that the action is unfolding quickly, like a construction site, you're talking short exposures frequently, maybe over the course of a work shift. You're the artist. You control the settings and tempo. I want to show you the nuances that we've learned about time lapses and how we feel they are optimally performed on Nikon cameras and how to have the best chance of not saying, I set up my camera, I sat out there for 8 hours, and my time lapse is garbage. Let me address one big thing first. Our Nikon cameras have interval timer shooting, but also time-lapse movie options on the camera. They are quite similar to set up, but there is one huge difference. The time-lapse movie option takes your photos, makes a video file out of them, and it's ready to watch immediately when you're done, even in the camera. I actually don't use that option very often. It is the easier, more efficient option to use, but it also gives you less flexibility on the final product compared to using interval timer shooting. Now, the disadvantage of interval timer shooting is that your initial product, in the camera at least, is not a time-lapse video file at all. It's a series of either JPEG or RAW images, your choice, to then use in editing software, to batch edit the images, and then use additional software to create a time lapse from them. I want to be clear here. There's nothing wrong with the time lapse movie option if that's your choice. In fact, like I said, the settings that I will talk about relative to interval timer shooting are much the same for the time lapse movie option also. Okay, interval timer shooting. Generally, we are creating hundreds or thousands of images. Why? So I can edit one as a representative example, generally a raw file, and then apply those edits across the board, or potentially apply and then tweak and then apply and then tweak. This gives you the most flexibility in editing. And also, yes, it takes up the most space and pushes your computer harder when working with the images. Raymond and I find it rewarding, so that's the direction that we go. So let's go to the interval timer shooting option on my Z50 here on the photo shooting menu, and let's do something different. Let's start at the bottom of the list and work our way up to the start button. This is how I do it in the field, and I'd recommend it. Starting storage folder. I like starting my time lapses in a new folder of images. This helps a ton when reviewing the images later on, especially if your memory card is going to have a mix of different time lapses and one-off still images on it. And yes, I reset the file numbering. Why? If your image counter is at, say, 9,950 when you start the time lapse, it's going to roll back over to zero during the time lapse. And it's a minor pain in the butt when you're sequencing the time lapse images later on. Don't worry if you accidentally skip these options. I certainly have, and it's just some inconvenience on the back end if you do skip them. Next up, interval priority. There's some good guidance in the help screen for this option. Basically, you're telling the camera whether or not to hold the interval timing at all costs or to prioritize getting the right exposure. For daylight time lapses, it's okay to turn this option off, especially if you're using aperture priority and want the camera to adapt to changing conditions. For astrophotography, I'm shooting in manual with the exact exposure, including the same shutter speed for each image. So there's no chance that my shutter speed is going to run longer than my interval. So consider the circumstances and determine which is more important for you to prioritize for your time lapse. The next option up on the Z50 is silent photography. We use it. You lose high 1 and high 2 options for ISO, flash, long exposure noise reduction, and flicker reduction. The only option we wish we had might be high ISO noise reduction. Especially for astrophotography, though, that's something that we'd actually rather control in post-processing so that we can balance between noise reduction and losing stars that might be interpreted by the camera as luminance noise. Incidentally, long exposure noise reduction lengthens the camera's processing time for each shot, which can completely interfere with your desired interval choice. Exposure smoothing. This is very helpful for landscape time lapses, and Nikon's implementation of this feature works ridiculously well. Basically, as long as you're not in fully manual mode, the camera will make gradual exposure changes during lighting changes so that the time lapse will appear smooth. Fundamentally, instead of simply metering to the current lighting, it checks the previous exposure to ensure that the change will not be drastic, and then again on the next shot, it checks the previous exposure to assure that smooth ramp during exposure changes. This helps to prevent sudden lighting changes or what's seen as rapid jumps in exposure when you're viewing the time lapse later on. Okay, now here's where things get serious. The intervals and the number of shots per interval. My screen usually looks something like this. Hundreds or thousands of images and one shot at each interval. Normally, you will want one shot per interval, and the number of intervals will be the number of shots that the camera is physically going to take. The camera does some math and tells you when the intervals would be expected to finish. That's very handy, but not all of the various Nikons we've used have this feature. As far as keeping it to one shot per interval, for a time lapse, that is going to keep everything very smooth. I'm not sure when I would want more than one shot per interval, perhaps for some scientific applications or observations, maybe for some fun action or something, but for the work I do, no specific examples come to mind. The interval. This can get a little tricky, especially for long exposure images at each interval. First, let me tell you what the interval isn't. It is not the amount of time between shots. And let me say that again. It is not the length of time between images. What the interval is the exact amount of time from the start of one shot to the start of the next shot. Now, if your shutter speeds are 1/100th of a second, let's say, it's no big deal. If your shutter speeds are 8 seconds long, don't set this at 4 seconds. It won't work. You'll lose images. In fact, if your shutter speeds are 8 seconds long, don't even set it at 8 seconds. The camera needs a moment to process each exposure once it's done. Depending on your camera, if you had an 8-second exposure, you might need to set the interval to 10 or even 12 seconds. I do wish there were a mode to say, give me 5 seconds between shots, no matter how long I set my exposure. But again, that's just not how it works. The key here is that it will take a picture every X seconds, whatever time period you choose for the interval. So make sure that you consider that your shutter speeds will need to be shorter than the interval. The best thing you can do here is to test once or twice before you set the camera off and running while you sit and read that next book in your queue. Finally, on the Z50, you can choose your start time. That's actually quite handy if you want to set and forget. Maybe you're camping and you want that golden hour sunset. You can set it up earlier in the day, set a start time, and take a sweet afternoon nap without having to disrupt the sleepy goodness by kicking off that time lapse. I mentioned earlier in this video that the interval timer feature on different Nikon bodies will look different. Slightly different verbiage, some different options. So Raymond is going to run through some of those differences for us.
Okay, I'm back. I'm going to talk to you about differences from what Leigh has shown you with the Z50 to the D810, the Z7, and the D780. The Z7 will be the same also as the Z6. First, the D810. The D810 does not have the options in the interval timer settings to make a new folder and to restart the numbering. You have to do that on your own, and I'm putting those options up on the screen to be able to do that. It does have exposure smoothing. You do set the number of intervals, but note you don't get the estimated duration or the completion time and date. So you got to kind of maybe do some math in your head to see when your time lapse is going to be done. What we tend to do is just set the time lapse for a ridiculous amount of images and then shut the camera off when we think we've got everything that we need. And you can choose the start, date, and time. That's a handy feature. Get it set up, do something else, and know that the camera is going to start doing the time lapse when the time that you set has come. The Z6 and Z7, you've already got them. The firmware and options and settings in the Z50 is in many cases the same as the Z6 and the Z7. There's certainly some exceptions, but when it comes to interval timer, smooth. Everything that Leigh told you before about the Z50 applies to both the Z6 and the Z7. That's a credit to the Z50, and it's a credit to the Z6 and Z7 as well. Finally, the D780, and it's got some tricks up its sleeve. It has the same options, but it also has the same options as the Z50, Z6, and Z7, except it also has a couple more. The very cool auto exposure bracketing during interval timer photography. So if the situation changes, you can use bracketing in your multiple shots per interval to under and overexpose while your time lapse is being taken. You're going to get more images. You're going to have more to work with in post, but you might just get something magical as the light changes. Now, here's another good one, time-lapse movie. This is going to get you the best of both worlds. Leigh talked earlier about how the time-lapse movie is not really the option that we like because you don't get the flexibility of editing the raw images in post-production. With the D780 and time-lapse movie, you get the images and then you also get the camera putting together a movie of those images, maybe sort of as a preview or, depending on the situation, maybe your final product. That's a really cool option. And of the different cameras that we've discussed, the D780 with those couple of additional options definitely has the most flexibility.
Okay, so what happens when you're done? For one, you may have filled up your memory card. So maybe before you get started, check that image counter on the camera and the number of intervals you have selected. It will actually let you choose more intervals than you have space for. Maybe a little warning about that Nikon would be nice. I like to format my memory card prior to a time lapse if I can. What else happens? In my case, now I have hundreds or even thousands of raw files. If you're familiar with batch editing in Lightroom or Capture One or wherever you like to edit, you're off and running. If not, don't worry, I've got a video coming very soon about how to take control of every aspect of the time lapse so that your final product was so worth the time that you spent alone with your camera getting all of those images. As always, now it's your turn down in the comments. Have you done time lapses with your DSLR or mirrorless camera? If so, What tips do you have for all of us? And if you haven't, what's holding you back and what questions do you have? And before you go, give this video a like if you found it helpful and subscribe to this channel if you haven't already. That kind of support goes a long way. And thank you very much for watching.